situation with the person at home wasn't going to be, I wasn't going to be able to move past the traumatic events that happened. I literally like lost my job like 2 days, the day before this happened. So I was still processing a lot of me being slammed to me losing my job that I had for a while. And I thought that I was going to have this job for a couple of years. I thought this was going to be one of the jobs that I had for a couple of years. So it was a lot to process. But the way that I came in contact with Ms. Sheila from Friendship Place was through one of my friends that I protest with. And he's also my friend from UDC. We started protesting around the George Floyd protest, and he has connections. So I contacted him to see if he knew anybody with that could help me with my situation. I explained to him what was going on, and he told me that he had somebody that I could get in contact with that would probably be able to give me housing. Just told me to call her, text her. And so I got in contact with Ms. Sheila the same night that I became homeless. And she told me what she needed. She asked me questions like, what did I need help with? If I needed food, if I had a place to go that night, where would I go if I did go to somewhere that night? And just making sure that I was good that night. She gave me a couple places to go to. She told me that she would follow up the next day so that we could do an assessment. So I went to work the next day. She did the assessment. She asked me if I had anywhere to go. And I told her I did. I ended up staying in a hotel that was gifted to me through one of the people from the protest community. They gave me the hotel for a week. I stayed in the hotel for a week. Then I left from the hotel and I went to stay on somebody's couch. And they let me stay on the couch for about 2 months, from June, July, for 3 months until August. And then I stayed in my car maybe once or twice. There was one or two nights where I had to stay in my car. I didn't really sleep those nights, but so I ended up having to call Ms. Sheila back and tell her that I don't have anywhere to go. The people's house I was staying over, I couldn't stay over there anymore. I'm probably gonna have to sleep in my car again tonight. I need somewhere to go. So she gave me the contact to come to Sasha Bruce. And I came here that same night with my clothes, and I had a bed and food. I had food in my stomach and a bed to sleep. So I was very appreciative of that, because I don't know, that's just, it was a blessing to have that. Sasha Bruce is the temporary living facility for youth ages 18 to 24. We have food every day, and we have 3 refrigerators. We have a PlayStation that you can play at any time. And they're really good people here. They care. They care about you. Miss Sheila, who is my case manager at Friendship Place, and she helped me do an assessment where they ended up finding that I was a good candidate for rapid rehousing. So rapid rehousing pays partial of your rent for a duration of a year. So we found out that I was a good candidate for the program, and I just had to wait for them to pick my name. And we waited, and I've been accepted into the program. I should be getting housed in the next week and a half. So it's a quick process. I'm feeling a little overwhelmed, but I'm actually excited to be moving and getting on my own 2 feet. The program's staying with me with a year. So they have a person that is in contact with me for counseling service. That one person that's getting in contact with me to help me with the jobs that I need, or any job that I want to maybe progress in, like just get a better paying job so that I can sustain myself and keep paying for my own rent. I have jobs right now, but I'm working to get a better job so that I can be able to sustain myself after the program. I was searching for a job from May until May, June, until mid-July. Really? I was looking for a job. I didn't have a job. And then something came through. One of my friends said, I have an opportunity. Went to the interview. It was quick and easy. Got that job. Then I got another job delivering Japanese alcohol. But I ended up getting one part-time job, then another part-time job. And now I have one full-time job and two part-time jobs. So things work out. Friends in Place has helped me tremendously from the time, like I said, that I got in contact with Sheila up until tonight. Like, Friendship Place has been very helpful in getting me in contact with different housing programs. It's also helped me with making sure that I get my important documents, such as like birth certificate, social security card, while I didn't have a place to go and I didn't have food to eat. Like, I would go to Friendship Place. They had food and they will have socks. Like, you understand how important socks are. They have socks up there. I have a washer and a dryer in case I didn't have it when I was staying on my people. When I was staying on my friends' couches, sometimes I didn't really have access to the washing machine. Friendship Place was great. There's been so many things that's happened. It's been a blessing.
These have been challenging times, and I am proud of how hard the staff and volunteers at Friendship Place have worked to meet these challenges. They've shown courage, innovation, resilience, and above all, caring to do what they need to do. Just as importantly, you know, we could never do what we do without you. And while the city and the federal government are generous, they do not fund all our needs or programs. Friendship Place needs all of you to do our work today and to grow into the future to meet the needs of people experiencing homelessness. Our work moves me because we treat people with respect, because we listen to participants to build Friendship Place, because this community movement that activated 30 years ago keeps on growing and helping more people each year. Our mission moves me. The way we deliver on its promise, the way it drives us to put people first and to keep getting better at what we do. Some of you online tonight already know that homelessness is a family story for me, with my brother being homeless right here in Georgetown years ago. And at the same time, looking back on my own story, a young immigrant of 18 by myself in California, living in hotel rooms by the week, downtown San Francisco, the friends I met there helped me. I did not experience the same kind of hardship that our young people here in Washington do when they live on the streets, but the fragility of that situation then is still in my mind. Your support allows us to find jobs for people who come to aim higher in hardship. It allows us to reach out to people on the streets and bring safety equipment to men and women who sleep in encampments, at bus stops, and bring all the services people need to rebuild their lives right to the street. It allows us also to operate the Welcome Center, to offer free psychiatric consultations, and to give people young and old a place to rest, to get some food, to do laundry, and access services again so they can rebuild their lives. I can't say enough about the blend of private and public funding that allows us to catch absolutely everybody on time. This blend makes the whole difference for so many people. During COVID, our programs continued to save lives. And even more, you've heard that we've opened the Brooks, this wonderful family facility on Idaho Avenue in Upper Northwest. We've also doubled our youth services, tripled our employment services, added new solutions for veterans, and housed even more people permanently. So COVID didn't stop us. In 2020, We prevented or ended homelessness for 2,664 people, including 535 veterans and 606 children. These numbers show how effective Friendship Place is. Now, we look to the future, to the higher level of need the pandemic will leave us with. More people at our door looking for food, for work, for housing. There will be even more to do than before. This is why we've launched an ambitious strategic plan. It has a lot of details in it, but I'm going to give you some highlights. We will find new solutions for people experiencing homelessness in the city and DC Metro, crafting this programming that works, the programming that we are known for. We will advocate for services and equity in the city and on the Hill, fight systemic racism, foster LGBTQ plus inclusion, and support groups building their own practices as we have across the country. We will build deeper relationships with our government partners because we know that none of us can do this work alone. We need to join arm in arm with our public servants to change how we do things and bring about systemic change. We will work to make sure that wherever somebody goes for services in DC Metro, that person is greeted with deep respect and finds solutions, finds programming that works. And I also have some wonderful news. We are about to open in Anacostia a short-term housing facility for singles, a first of its kind, bridge housing that will help people move from encampments to permanent supportive housing within 90 days. So we're very excited about this. These are big endeavors, but I know we can count on you to be there by our side, to build a stronger system together, a system strong enough to catch people on time and end chronic homelessness. With you by our side, we're nimble and quick. We can act now when people need the help. You allow us to say yes to people who have heard no too many times. You allow us to create new solutions when new problems come up. Your support can provide things that some people may take for granted: a security deposit, a first month's rent, a place to store belongings so you don't lose them, a bag of groceries or a prescription delivered at someone's door so the person doesn't have to go out during the pandemic, an ID so someone can get a job, and a pair of boots so someone can take that construction job, not walk away defeated, feeling left behind. At Friendship Place, we task ourselves with developing privately funded solutions so we don't leave anybody behind. We need your help to do this now more than ever. We need your help to catch people on time, to end cycles of homelessness, to keep families and single people housed. Thank you so much for everything you do for us. I deeply appreciate it. Thank you for being such good friends of Friendship Place.
I live in Ward 3 near UDC, and I'm so grateful to have been able to work together with many of you across our city. Looking at all the beautiful faces on our screens, I am in awe of the power we collectively possess, the power of our voices, the power to act to make change in our city. The presence of all of us here right now is proof of the power of the organizing and learning and growing we and Wynn here in Northwest DC have done over the past more than 3 years. Maybe we were together on the bus tours to the Wharf and Navy Yard and RFK and Berry Farm. Maybe we were on Zoom at a Wynn RFK action or a budget hearing or a Wynn climate training, or you're a regular at our Wynn Ward 3 congregation's monthly meetings. We've inspired each other to think outside our bubbles, to look at our histories with clear eyes, and to imagine ourselves acting to repair the effects of that history. Today, I see all of you, and I see the power of Wynn congregations, old and new, I see the power of new WIN leaders from churches, synagogues, and mosques all over our city. I'm seeing the power and passion of our young people, students from Wilson, Jackson Reed High School, Georgetown Day School, Gonzaga, UDC, and our local universities. Thank you all for opening your hearts and minds, for giving your time, your energy, your soul to this work of affordable, safe, secure green housing for everyone in our city, especially here in Ward 3.
We gather as your people. We gather from across Ward 3, from different houses of worship, from different schools and community organizations, we gather. We gather, O God, with common cause, with a shared vision of your justice, with a vision of a house and a home for all your children, one they can actually afford. Inspire, bless, unite, and strengthen us. For by your mercy and light, O God, shall your justice prevail. Amen.
We are strong in numbers and the institutions we represent here, and now we want to acknowledge you and give you a shout out. Maddie?
Yes, we encourage you all now to turn your cameras on as we go through the groups that are being represented on this call. So if you can give a thumbs up or write your name in the chat and where you're calling from and react using the reactions button on the bottom panel of your screen, that'd be great. Also feel welcome to take a few photos as we go through this roll call and post them on social media with the hashtag VoteWinDC to publicize this event within your own circles.
Good afternoon, students, congregation members, neighbors, friends, and allies. It is amazing to see well over 400 people come together on this Sunday afternoon. But what's even more amazing is to think about the why and the how of this gathering. My name is Ann Michael. I'm a member of National United Methodist Church, and I've been involved in the work of the Washington Interfaith Network since it came into existence 25 years ago. And I have witnessed firsthand how power is created when an organization is committed to bringing people together across racial, socioeconomic, religious, and political divisions. East of the river and west of the park, there is not another citywide organization that stands in this space, which is why I believe WIN is so important, so effective, and so powerful on issues of affordable housing, environmental protection, economic justice, community safety, and so many others. And this type of power is what makes change in our city. In gathering today, we continue in a long line of organizing that has resulted in hundreds of millions of dollars of public funds for neighborhood redevelopment, improving parks, libraries, community centers, and underserved neighborhoods. It has preserved more than 500 units of affordable housing. It has built hundreds of new affordable homes for working families. We have advocated successfully for permanent supportive housing, for the closure of the deplorable shelter at DC General Hospital, and we have successfully battled NIMBYism here in Ward 3 in support of the Brooks. And our work in Ward 3 is in solidarity with work currently going on across the district to increase Black home ownership, demand inclusive development on public lands, and create living wage jobs. We build power district-wide by building relationships through a deliberate discipline of getting to know one another and discerning common interests, by setting a common agenda, by holding ourselves accountable to our mutual agreements, and by holding public officials accountable for their commitments. And this is why it matters that we are here. This is why it matters that each of you is here this afternoon as we set our sights on the important objective of bringing more affordable housing and more green housing to Ward 3.
This is the first time that we've had an action solely focused on Ward 3. An action that brings together houses of worship, students, and neighbors who have studied our history and believe that it is time for Ward 3 to build affordable, green housing. Each of you here today is a pioneer as we build the power that we need to transform our neighborhoods. And faith-based organizing goes all the way back to biblical times when Moses and God and the Israelites ran an action on Pharaoh and said, let my people go. So what are we doing? We are building power here in Rock Creek West to advocate for healthy, safe, clean, and green housing. Will you say that with me? I know we can't hear each other, but I want to know that you're saying it in your house. Healthy, safe, clean, and green housing. One more time. Healthy, safe, clean, and green housing. We know that our city leaders don't have a lot of faith in us, that attempts to expand affordable housing opportunities in Rock Creek West have always been greeted with vocal opposition. When affordable housing policies are proposed for our neighborhoods, they have always been greeted with a hearty chorus of "not in my backyard." So we are building power together to say yes in our backyard. Not just that we'll accept affordable housing in Ward 3, but that we demand it. And we're not just focused on our own neighborhoods. As Rabbi Joachim Prince said at the March on Washington, neighbor is not a geographic term, it is a moral concept.
Before we conclude, I want to refer back to the words everyone posted in the chat at the start of this call, so you can all see what our joint vision for housing looks like. Pretty amazing. Equity, liberation, unified and loving, green spaces, welcome.
Good afternoon, my name is Ryan Nickens. I'm a native Washingtonian, a member of the historic Metropolitan AME Church and a Ward 7 resident. I founded and run a nonprofit in the district that provides mental health support for victims of gun violence. Through my work, I invest in the district, but I cannot afford to buy a home in my own city. With student loan debt and then in my nonprofit salary, I'm afraid I will never be able to. When we know that we do not live single issue lives and we are not single issue voters, the issues on our agenda are all interconnected.
Good afternoon. I'm here for one reason and one reason only. And that is because I believe that a different Washington, D.C. is possible. Do you believe that a different Washington, D.C. is possible? If you believe it, say it with me. A different Washington, D.C. is possible. One more time. A different Washington, D.C. is possible. Beloved, the city as we see it, unequal, was never the dream of God. It is the result of human policymaking. It is a result of human politics. Let me be very clear, the inequality that we see in Washington is an inequality that permeates the United States of America. The FHA Act excluded Black people from being able to thrive in suburbs. We use tax dollars from Black and brown people to build white suburban wealth. We took from one group and gave to others and helped them to build wealth, but it does not have to stay there.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Jamie Butler. I'm a member of Addis Israel Congregation. I live in Chevy Chase, DC. I've been here for 52 years, 38 of them in Chevy Chase. I raised two daughters who graduated from Wilson High School, and until 2 years ago, I didn't know that land on Broad Branch Road was taken by Black owners by eminent domain so that Lafayette Elementary School and the park there could be built for whites only, right? Most of us didn't know that. It's only when you start digging around and looking into our shameful history that we learn it. 1928, that happened. So we can't give that land back to the people that live there, but we can fund and create opportunities for Black home ownership in Ward 3. And we can build more affordable housing in Ward 3, because Ward 3 is for everybody and not just whites.
Let's organize. Together, this is strength in numbers. If we stay organizing, we can't lose. As Ryan said earlier, we do not live single issue lives. 4 years ago, my son was injured by gun violence. I too endorsed the WIN agenda for public safety. I am a 5th generation Washingtonian and a Ward 8 native. I vote for those who were displaced, all those fighting to get back, and all those who want to stay. I believe those who were here in the, during the poverty deserves the right to stay here during the prosperity.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there. Beyond the sky, it's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Yeah, your names and your faces hopefully are projected on a big screen in front of the candidates right now. One candidate is here virtually, so feel free to wave, put yourself on camera and wave. They can see you on a big screen.
Good evening. Welcome. My name is Rabbi Aaron Alexander, and I am one of the rabbis here at Addis Israel Congregation on behalf of the Washington Interfaith Network, on behalf of Friendship Place. We want to welcome our council candidates, our organizers, our advocates, and our community members, otherwise known as voters. And more than 200 of them tonight. We look forward to a rich and thoughtful presentation tonight, particularly surrounding the challenges and opportunities presented by housing and homing in our ward, Ward 3. Before I go any further, I just want to take a very brief moment to thank two of our leaders, Barbara Kraft of Temple Sinai and Jamie Butler of Addis Israel. And Lynn Amato of Friendship Place, thank you. Barbara and Jamie in particular are our co-leaders of the Ward 3 Affordable Housing Working Group. So why are we here? Why are we here in this beautiful sanctuary, surrounded by religious imagery and with the holy scrolls of the Torah in this stunning ark behind me, behind y'all? We don't endorse. We are nonpartisan as a rule and also as a value. So why here? Why a house of worship? Primarily because we in the faith and advocacy community, we deeply believe that access to dignified housing is quite simply a right of the every, not a privilege of the few or even just the many. It is a right of the every. The scrolls behind me, they tell the story of a people on the run in search of but one necessity, a place they can call home, the dignity of shelter. From Genesis 12 on, that's the book. That's the dream. That's the sacred aspiration. But even before getting there, before the actualization of that dream, the Israelites, they were commanded by God, create a society, a new kind of ancient civilization, one that never forgets its own story of degradation, one that won't, one that can't neglect the most vulnerable to unnecessary suffering over and over and over again. The Torah, the Bible, the five books of Moses, it asks us to protect and provide for the previously unprotected through the establishment of just laws, fair policies, and stewarded by individuals called to service with love. And that is what we believe this city, this ward, ought to promote and provide. A Ward 3 for all. But we, from here forward, we're not policymakers. I'm a rabbi, not an expert in affordable housing. Actually, I have little expertise in most areas. But in the faith community, we do have an essential civic role to play. What we can do is humbly offer up our priorities into the public square along with all others. And we offer not only sacred texts, but more importantly, the voices and stories of the too often marginalized by a vicious status quo. We organize, we listen, we learn, and then we ideally become holy conduits between the vision and those invested by the voters to construct and maintain that vision. Just that. We do have some experts among us, though. I'm going to call upon my friend Jean-Michel Girard, the president and CEO of Friendship Place, to offer words of welcome as well. He is very much an expert. But before that, once again, thank you for being here. And thank each of you for your potential service as a council member to our beloved Ward 3 community. Welcome.
Well, good evening, everybody. I'm Jean-Michel Giraud, the president and CEO of Friendship Place. And we're delighted to see so many of you with us tonight, and I know online as well. I want to start by thanking the rabbi for his welcome here in this beautiful venue. We're delighted to be here, partnering with Wynn and Addis Israel on tonight's event. Our ties with the synagogue and Anne Frank House, which has been a beacon of light for people experiencing homelessness in Ward 3 for many, many years, do go back many years of a very productive and fruitful collaboration. So we are very thankful. Friendship Place is a homeless services organization serving the DC metropolitan area with an array of personally crafted solutions and with a national impact through best practices. We also work to foster a greater acceptance of people experiencing homelessness and receiving housing assistance in DC. Affordable housing is a central issue in the city as redevelopment makes housing resources scarcer each year for people in lower economic brackets. The relatively small size of our jurisdictions further complicates matters since DC services do not reach beyond city bounds into less costly suburbs and exurbs. As the urban center of the metropolitan area, DC also has a higher number of people experiencing homelessness than bordering jurisdictions. The statistics do show this year that the rate of homelessness has gone down again. This is part of an encouraging trend that started several years ago, but a high number of people live in encampments. We have made progress in our response to homelessness, significant progress in the city, but much work remains to be done in order to end homelessness in the district by making it rare, brief, and non-recurrent. In the context of this year's political campaign, candidates must face the challenges and responsibilities elected office will bring around housing. The main challenge for us at Friendship Place is to ensure that every Washingtonian has a place to call home. DC Council members will play a key role to meet this challenge in the next few years. Friendship Place stands ready to help make this, our vision, come true. Thank you so much. And now I'd like to introduce WIN leader Elizabeth Vaden of St. Columbus.
Good evening and welcome, neighbors, friends, allies, and WIN congregations. Those of you joining us here in person and those joining us via Zoom. And good evening to our hardworking candidates. We really appreciate you being here. I'd like to thank Rabbi Alexander and Otis Israel congregation for hosting us in this beautiful worship space. It is so good to be here together with you. I'm Elizabeth Vaden, a parishioner at St. Columbus Episcopal Church and a member of WIN's Ward 3 Affordable Housing Work Group. I live in Ward 3, a couple of blocks from Friendship Heights. WIN Ward 3 is delighted to be co-sponsoring tonight's forum with Friendship Place. I've had the pleasure of going out canvassing on a few occasions over the past few months with students from area high schools, listening to our neighbors share their thoughts on issues of housing and homelessness right here in Ward 3. Door after door, I heard a recurring message. Our neighbors recognize that many lower income families and individuals, including some who work here, can't afford to live here. They and we want that to change. Ward 3 has some distinctive challenges when it comes to making that change happen, and we're excited to hear tonight how these candidates propose to work with the mayor's office and city agencies to tackle those challenges. Thank you for being here. Now I'm going to pass the mic to fellow WIN Ward 3 member Ann Michael of National United Methodist Church, who will lead our question and answer session.
Good evening. My name is Ann Michael, and for the past 40 years, I've been a proud resident of the District of Columbia and a member of National United Methodist Church here in Ward 3. I've been active as a leader in the Washington Interfaith Network since its birth in 1996, and I currently also serve as the vice chair of Friendship Place's board of directors. I'm so honored to be moderating tonight's forum. I will be posing five questions focused specifically on housing issues here in Ward 3. These questions have been crafted by the WIN Affordable Housing Working Group and Friendship Place's Advocacy Committee. The candidates have received these questions in advance so that they could prepare succinct responses. Each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to each question. Our timekeeper, Abby, is sitting in the first row in the black and white. We have a low-tech timekeeping system. She has a green, yellow, and red card. Green means go. Yellow means you have 30 seconds left. and red means stop. When Abby stands up, it means really stop. When we get to our substantive questions, I will be calling on each candidate in a random order that was determined for each separately for each question. But before we move to those questions, we want to allow each candidate a minute to introduce themselves. And so I will be calling on those candidates in alphabetical order. And as I call your name, please come forward to the mic and offer your introduction. Ben.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Ben Bergman. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the folks who are joining us online. I think, you know, what we're going to talk about today is a central issue of this race. It's the central issue of every race this June. And it has been in multiple elections for the past number of years. And the reason is that there's a lot of recognition in the district that we have a problem. The rhetoric is all there. Everyone agrees what we need to do at a high level. The problem is that our values are not reflected in our actions consistently. And that's why the work of the people in this room matters so much, because values sometimes can live in the mind, but sometimes there's a disconnect from the heart. And I think when we talk about some of these conversations in Ward 3 that I've had with voters, it's been difficult to get through to people, to connect with them about human beings who live in their community. So thank you very much. I see the stop sign.
Thank you. Deidre Brown.
Good evening. I just wanted to introduce myself quickly. I am a Native, third generation Native Washingtonian. I was raised in a Catholic church, and that has really been my moral compass on making decisions as I've moved forward. When I went back to law school at the age of 37 while raising children, I decided to attend the UDC David A. Clark School of Law because it is a social justice school, and I wanted to use my law degree to help people. One of the clinics that I participated in while in the law school was landlord and tenant court, where we represented tenants who needed help. I then moved into the title world. I own a title company where I spent a lot of my time advocating for housing legislation at the Wilson Building. So I look forward to talking to you tonight about housing and affordable housing in Ward 3. Thank you.
Thank you. Candidate Tricia Duncan is joining us tonight virtually. So I am going to invite her to introduce herself now online.
Thank you. I want to thank everyone for accommodating me. I am on a previous commitment with a group of students and we're having a lovely time, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself. I love interfaith organizations. I am a member of St. Patrick's Episcopal Church, along with my husband and my two kids. I do a lot of work with So Others May Eat and Samaritan Ministries. But the first time that I heard that we need affordable housing in every ward was from the pulpit. I also teach Sunday school, and the values that come with caring for others. And when it comes to affordable housing and helping people experiencing homelessness, I do believe that Ward 3 has a big heart and we're ready to do more, but it's gonna take a leader to help people along with change that comes with affordable housing and the fears that people have that are misplaced. And I'm very familiar with people who have these feelings, but I have a deep-rooted belief that this is something that Ward 3 is ready for, and I'm looking forward to moving the ward along. And thank you for having me via Zoom. Hello, candidates.
Thank you, Ms. Duncan. Henry Cohen.
Hello, everybody. My name is Henry Cohen, and I'm a different kind of candidate for Ward 3. I'm a currently enrolled high schooler at Woodrow Wilson or Jackson Reed High School right here in Ward 3. And that's something that's central to me is schools, and something that I want to touch on here. We often don't think of schools as a housing issue, but they really are. I've been lucky enough to benefit from some amazing public schools at Stoddard Elementary and at my high school here in Ward 3. And that's something that I want every single person in DC to be able to share. That's something that I want every single person, regardless of socioeconomic status, regardless of family status, regardless of class, to be able to experience in DC. That means that we need to build more affordable housing in Ward 3. That means that we need to build better affordable housing in Ward 3. We need to make it easier to build affordable housing in Ward 3. That's why I'm proud to say that I'm the Yes in My Backyard candidate. That's why I'm proud to say that I support tons of affordable housing anywhere in Ward 3. And that's why I'm proud to have worked with WIN in the past, both as a member of the Community Coalition for Change at my school and with WIN itself, knocking doors alongside some of our moderators. I'm going to continue to be fighting for affordable housing and make sure that everybody can receive this great childhood that I got to experience in Ward 3. Thank you.
Thank you. Bo Findlay.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Bo Findlay. I am chair of Advisory Neighborhood Commission 3C. We're currently in 3C. I live across the street, the Quebec House. I'm also Ward 3 committee man to the DC Democratic State Committee. I serve with Shelley Tompkin, who's here tonight. My resume, quick overview, as exciting as it is, I've spent 14 years as a federal attorney with the FCC and 2 years as a government auditor with the U.S. Department of Transportation, where I oversaw $1.8 billion capital program. Had to make sure, as exciting as it was, that every penny added up. This campaign, to me, is about dignity. What does that mean? Dignity means not having to worry about being able to pay your rent, not having to worry about having a roof over your head, not worrying about where your next meal is coming from, not having to make a difficult choice between lunch, housing, and healthcare. Dignity means being able to go to the best school the district can offer. Dignity means aging in place gracefully. And so please join my campaign for a vibrant, stronger, more just DC. Thank you.
Thank you. Matthew Fruman.
Thank you very much. I'm Matt Fruman, and it is so great to be here with WIN tonight. I have been a part of WIN for 10 years through my temple, Temple Sinai. And I believe in coalitions, and WIN using its power of coalitions has made a real difference. I'm very proud to have been a part of the WIN Ward 3 Housing Network work over the last year and seen the coalition growing here in Ward 3 in support of affordable housing. It's bringing a new voice to the table, the faith-based community, that is really important in this discussion. One of the things we've grappled with is the history that we have in this area of exclusion, and we have to overcome that history of exclusion. We have a duty to do that, but also if we can build a ward that is diverse economically, racially, we will all be better for it. And so join me in building that better future. Thank you. Thank you.
Eric Goulet.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Eric Goulet. Thank you for having us here at this lovely sanctuary tonight. And thanks for everybody who's joining on screen tonight as well. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about myself. I moved to Washington, D.C. back in 2003, came straight from law school at Notre Dame, took the bar, and then I just came here because I felt a need to enter public service. I was fortunate enough to meet Councilmember Sandy Allen, who was the Ward 8 council member at the time. And that was my first job working with the District of Columbia government on the Committee for Health and Human Services. And what a time it was. I got to learn about the values of the community. I got to travel across the city and meet many great people. And that's always stuck with me, because throughout my career as budget director for DC and as the council's budget director, I've tried to live those values. I'm proud to talk about my record of achievement in those roles tonight to deliver affordable housing for residents across this city. And I just want to say thank you all for coming out, and I appreciate the time tonight.
Thank you. Monty Monash.
Thank you. First, I wanted to just say the last time I was in this congregation was my son was playing a klezmer band and we were dancing with the Torah. So this is nice to be back here, a little more subdued, but I want to thank you for having us here today as candidates. I want to just share a little bit about me. I'm a native Washingtonian, a mother of two boys, and a committed servant to this board and throughout the city. I have dedicated a lot of my time, and many of you are familiar faces because you know that I've volunteered without any kind of glory or grace, just to be the face and the voice for people in the community and throughout the city. I want to say that housing is important. I've talked about it a lot on this campaign trail. As I knock doors and meet more neighbors, it is the number one issue that comes out throughout all of the conversations. People will have safety and other issues, but housing is an issue that is central to this. I believe that homelessness is a huge issue. I've dedicated my time to it as a member of the board of Friendship Place in the past. I also have done other things with Friendship Terrace and other organizations that has shown my commitment to this community. Thank you.
Thank you. And Phil Thomas.
Did I gotta use the mic? That's
right. Well, you please, for the benefit of our online audience, I think it would be helpful. Yes.
So my name is Phil Thomas. I am running on a platform called 3 S's and an H. One is for seniors, as we need a senior wellness center in Ward 3, someplace that's ADA accessible and Metro accessible. The other S is for schools, as we need to reduce overcrowding, and I support the mayor's vision to put a new high school at the GDS property and really leverage other modes of transportation, like bringing the circulator and the completion of the trolley trail. The other S is safety, as we need to drive down crime, and that's taking a holistic approach and investing in violence interrupters, incredible messengers, and roving leaders, as really hone in on mental health and behavioral health as well. And the last letter is H, which is different from the other S's, which is housing, as we need more affordable housing in Ward 3, as well as workforce housing, so our teachers and our firefighters and our public safety officers can live in the community in which they serve. So over the course of this forum today, you heard me talk about 3 S's and an H a lot, which is schools, safety, seniors, and housing. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Thank you, candidates. We're now going to turn to our first question, and that question is this. Ward 4 council member Janice Lewis George recently introduced the Green New Deal for Housing Act. It would create publicly owned mixed income housing that uses rent cross subsidization to create deeply affordable units. What is your view of this bill and how do you see it working in Ward 3? I'll call first on Deidre Brown.
Thank you for the question. I think that this is a great bill. As you know, almost all the council members have signed on to it. If I was on the city council, I would vote yes. I think that the way it should be used in Ward 3 is that we use the buildings that we have, turn them into the social housing, where we are making sure that there is a mix. I believe the bill calls for 30% of market rate, 30% of deeply affordable, and 30% of 80% or less AMI. So I'm in support of the bill.
Thank you. I'm going to call next on Tricia Duncan, who'll be speaking online.
Thank you. I think this bill has a lot of heart and a lot of merit. I would support this bill if I was on the council. I will say how it would actually work. One of my concerns is the city, their track record on actually maintaining and doing the actual management. I could see some of our wonderful nonprofits actually managing these sites and making sure that these tenants continue to live in dignity and that the building is maintained. So I see this as a positive thing, but I can see some third party management with people with experience being a benefit here.
Thank you. What is your view of the bill and how do you see it working in Ward 3? Henry Cohen.
First off, I would proudly vote yes on this bill. I believe it's a great step forward in the fight for affordable housing to make Ward 3 livable for everybody. I really commend council member for putting forward this great piece of legislation. I believe that having third-party management from nonprofits is a noble idea, but I believe ultimately corporations have shown and non-government actors have shown that they do not have the best record when it comes to things like this, which is why I would fully support publicly owned, publicly managed housing, and that make sure that housing is affordable for everyone, make sure that everybody has the ability to live and work in this wonderful ward. As well, when it comes to specific sites for housing, a lot of candidates up here are gonna say that they support the bill, and then as soon as sites are named, gonna say, oh, I have a problem with this site, this site, this site. I'm going to support the first site that is mentioned here in this bill. The first site for affordable housing, I pledge that I will support. I'm going to support the next site and the next one because I believe that Ward 3 needs to be livable for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. What is your view of the bill and how do you see it working in Ward 3? Phil Thomas.
Yeah. Yes, as we know, we need more housing across the city, but also in Ward 3. I would definitely look at the bill as we know and continue to invest in the Housing Production Trust Fund. As we know that also work with the developer and make sure that the housing gets built. I would definitely look at the bill. I'm leaning to support it. I would definitely think more about it, talk to my colleagues about it, but I definitely know we need more housing in Ward 3, and I can deliver on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Monty Monash.
Thank you for the question. I believe that I would support the bill if I were on the council, and I would support the bill because of the fact that we do have to use innovation. We have to have some creative tools to make sure that we increase our housing stock, make sure that we have more housing available for all kinds of residents in this ward and throughout the city. In particular, I do like the idea that Tricia mentioned. I was thinking the same thing, is that Friendship Place has been a great example of how an outside organization or a party comes in and helps to manage city-owned properties, and they have a track record of making sure that happens. I know right now our housing authority is having a lot of problems and issues that needs to be adjusted, retooled, refashioned. So we don't want to only depend on our district government agency. We also need to use the experts that we have in our community to make sure that it's run properly and it's maintained well. Thank you.
Thank you. Eric Goulet, what is your view of the bill and how would you see it work in Ward 3?
I was very interested with the bill when it came out. I think it's a unique concept. It works elsewhere in the world. And I definitely would be open to supporting the bill. I do want to see the public hearing first, hear the testimony on that. I think it's always very important to listen to the public and get tweaks to the bill. And I do like the idea, has been mentioned twice now, about perhaps having nonprofits manage the funding. I don't think having funding flowing through the DC government is the way to go on this. I think the nonprofits have the expertise to potentially manage the housing in a way that would be more served than DC government. And I think DC government, to be honest, is better in an oversight capacity than managing direct services in this instance. I also think what we should do is roll it out on a pilot basis to make sure we get it right. I don't think that should replace all the great work we're doing in housing right now with the Housing Production Trust Fund, with workforce housing. I would also focus a lot more on transitional housing too. I think that that's gonna be really important as a component for our comprehensive housing network to deal with residents who have substance use issues. So I think this definitely has a role in that network, but I think we should roll it out slowly and we should make sure we do it right.
Thank you. Matthew Fruman.
Thank you. I think it's just a great bill and I would definitely support it. I also, at the same time, Janice Lewis-George proposed a bill on removing lead pipes that would be a great job creator and create more safety for people around the city. In terms of it, we need every tool in the toolbox to get affordable housing and to increase our housing stock, and this will be one way. In terms of how it might work in the ward, in some ways, this echoes work that Wynn has done. When you look at the proportions for, you know, a third below 30%, a third between 30 and 50, and a third market rate, it sounds like what Wynn has been advocating at Reservation 13 and at the Lincoln Theater. And I think Wynn should pat itself on the back for its advocacy on this. The Chevy Chase Rec Center seems like a place where you might try this. We want to build housing on top of it. Could we use this as a pilot to get this started and get the kind of housing one-third, 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 and testing the social housing model there? I think it's an exciting opportunity, and I hope to be a part of it.
Thank you. Bo Findlay.
Thank you. So it's great to hear some of my fellow candidates now supporting social housing. This is something I've been arguing for since the beginning of this campaign. I want to tell you a story. I have a neighbor who is on fixed income. She's a senior citizen. She lives across the street, actually across the parking lot in Quebec House. And she is seeing a rental increase of $40 a month. That works out to $480 a year. Doesn't seem like much to a lot of us here, I'm sure. She's considering doing laundry less. She's considering changing her sheets less frequently. And she's considering not taking her medication on a regular basis just to pay for her rent. We're in the middle of an affordable housing crisis. That means that we need to go beyond leveraging every tool in our housing production toolbox and create new innovative tools. You know, forge new ones like expanding rent stabilization, social housing, which I'm glad folks are now on board with, and procuring our own housing stock where the DC builds a housing portfolio, takes the revenues, makes capital upkeep changes, and then uses the profits to build affordable housing. We need to take all these options and go to war against poverty right now. Thank you.
All right. And finally, Ben Bergman.
So I love two things about this bill. One, it's finally a rejection of the provincialism that infects American policymaking, where we can't look to other parts of the world where things are implemented and work just fine. Social housing is popular in Europe. We can do it here. The other thing is the big thing. And we have to be willing to do big things to make progress on reversing segregation, on making housing affordable in the city. That's not something you can do with 900 units here, 300 units here. We need to be doing thousands of units in this city every year if we want to actually make a difference, if we want this actually to be a place where everyone can live. So that means that this can't be the only thing we do, but it can be part of it, and it should be. Thanks.
Thank you, candidates. So we'll move on now to our second question. And the question is this: the Rapid Rehousing Program provides families and individuals with rental support for 12 to 18 months. 90% of these families will not be able to afford their rent at the end of their subsidy. Would you support funding to allow families and individuals to remain in their housing until they are able to afford their own rent, or would you propose a different solution? So we'll hear first from Matt Fruman.
So programs like this are not intended to be a Band-Aid that you lift off after a short while. And once we are housing people, we have an obligation to keep them in housing. Whether or not it's extending the lease where they are or finding a new place for them, you can't bring people in off of the streets and then 12, 18 months later say good luck. That is a recipe for disaster, and we shouldn't do it. And we need to make the commitment, not just to help those people who are in the Rapid Rehousing Program, but people everywhere around the city who are unhoused. You don't do it in half measures. You do it right. If it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. Thank you.
Thank you. Eric Goulet.
One of the things the city needs to do a lot better in is follow through and working with people. There is no way that 2 years is enough time for a family to just then be able to, you know, be on their own. We need to use a comprehensive approach with wraparound services. And that's going to include job training. It's going to include birth to three services or pre-K services, which I'm proud to have worked on funding both of those acts here. We need to give a family or an individual the type of stabilizing services they need. And it's a variety of services. It could be behavioral health. It could be tailored to that individual need. And some families may be able to go off of the program at that time. Others may not. Others may be able to contribute more than they were before. Others may not. And we need to have a more nuanced approach where we have case managers working directly with these families and not have a hard and fast shutoff. I think oversight by the council is going to be key on that, to make sure that our agency is following through and working very diligently to address these needs on an individualized basis.
Thank you. Again, the question is, would you support funding to allow families to remain in housing, or would you propose a different solution? Phil Thomas.
Yes, as Ward 3 council member, I would make sure that we use all the tools in the toolbox for individuals, that we make sure they have opportunity, as well as use wraparound services. As somebody who worked on the short-term family housing site in Ward 3, and somebody who fostered support and worked with the community, as well as worked with the government, as well as came to agreement to put a parking garage there on Idaho Avenue for our police cab parking, as well as worked with the commissioner, Maureen Boucher, to move the playground from the side of the resident to the back of the parking lot. As somebody who delivered the short-term family housing for Ward 3 and for Housing for All, I would definitely fight for residents who need rapid rehousing and continue to do that as Ward 3 council member. Thank you.
Thank you. Henry Cohen.
So first off, I want to say that it's incredibly important that we continue to allow people to live in subsidized housing, which is why I'm going to just say it instead of waffling around it, dancing around it. Yes, I support extending rapid rehousing rental support. I in fact support expanding it indefinitely so that people who need to live and work in DC can live and work in DC, can afford to live and work in DC in this great city. There's two sides to the housing problem. There's supply and demand.
Housing, despite being a right, has oftentimes become a commodity, and that's still true in Washington, D.C. In order to decrease price, we need to increase supply. That means doing things like ending single-family zoning. It means doing things like make sure that we are letting people build major developments that have multiple apartments and multifamily zoning. And this will, in turn, lower prices to make sure that people can afford it. But in the meantime, we should definitely be funding rapid rehousing. We should definitely be making sure that we're not putting people back on the streets after 1 year, after 2 years, after 5 years. Nobody should be put back on the streets in D.C. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cohen. Next will be Tricia Duncan online.
Thank you. I've been asked to time myself because I think I've been hogging. So I've got my timer going. Thank you. I'm very familiar with the rapid rehousing program. We have two buildings in my neighborhood that house these tenants. We absolutely need to extend the time and money that we put towards, we should not be kicking people out after 12 or 18 months, but ideally we get people on a plan within 12 to 18 months, because right now the way the system works is the residents, at least in our neighborhood, they get one phone call a week after likely living, in a tent community for a long time. The tents get cleared, they come to our neighborhood and they get one phone call a week. We need to do better by these residents. We can do better. And yeah, in short, as a council member, I'm gonna see that these programs are funded properly, and particularly for the residents who might be suffering from learning differences, it's a problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Deidre Brown.
Thank you. I'm in support of extending the rapid rehousing, but I want to point out that we need to make sure that we are really looking at all the reasons why someone may be in that position. It can be something as simple as, we have a lot of families who are living paycheck to paycheck, you lose your job. And so we want to make sure that we are figuring out what does that individual family or person need in order for them to become stable, so that they can then move on through the housing program. In the beginning, we should be providing them with as much rental assistance as they need, even if that's at 100%. And then we gradually, over time, reduce that as their income increases and as they become more stable. We cannot give up on people. We have a moral obligation to make sure that everyone has affordable and safe housing here in Ward 3. Thank you.
Thank you. Beau Findlay.
Yes, I support funding these families. The rapid rehousing program is essential. We need to provide bridge funding to continue it for these 913 families. We need to provide programmatic support, which means, access to healthcare. It means help navigating DC bureaucracy. It means, job training. I think the Jobs First program is a great pilot. I can't wait to see it succeed citywide. We absolutely need to fund the rapid rehousing program fully. We need to make sure these families are not forced back into homelessness. We don't want anybody to experience the trauma of homelessness, and we don't want anybody to have to experience that trauma again. Thank you.
Thank you. Ben Bergman.
So this sort of reminds me of actually the last question. A lot of the skepticism around social housing comes from people's perspectives around public housing. And it's a similar issue to what we're talking about right now. When you design programs to fail because you do not provide the sufficient funding, you can't be surprised when you're not getting the results you need. And so I wanna agree and disagree with something Henry said. Housing isn't a right. It should be, but it isn't. Rights don't have waiting lists and they don't have an early termination period. And so if we really care about these things, we have to be willing to make hard choices. And that means looking at the budget and caring about our priorities. And that means being willing to raise taxes if that's what we have to do, which I would be willing to do because we absolutely need to extend the program. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Monty Monash.
Thank you. So rapid rehousing is an intense situation for anybody that's in that type of program, in that kind of situation. And when those intense situation happens, a lot of things are not equally placed. So it's not like it's this construct or structure that people are experiencing homelessness or housing insecurity that can just be
checked off a checklist, but there are some commonalities that we can do as a government and as a city to try to make sure that those families are supported. So what I would do is first and foremost, absolutely extend the time that folks are in the rapid rehousing program, because you do need that time. Caseworkers need to understand the root cause. You need to peel back all the issues to understand each individual case so that it can be accommodated for, and not everybody's experiencing the same thing. There might be some things that flow up as an average or a common theme, but it's all individualized. So we need to, as a city, make sure that we're paying attention to those needs. Extending that time is an absolute must. And I know that in partnership with churches and other civic organizations, these things will come about in partnership with the district. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, candidates. Our third question is this. There is little public land in Northwest DC on which to build affordable housing. The mayor has funded the Housing Production Trust Fund to unprecedented levels. Should DC acquire property in Ward 3 to build housing? Where should the funds come from? We'll hear first from Deidre Brown.
Yes, I believe that we should try any and everything we can to increase the number of affordable housing in Ward 3. If not, we're never going to reach our numbers. So we should be purchasing or using buildings and land in the district that is available to us. The funding needs to come from the budget. We have a budget surplus. We can also work with nonprofits and developers. We can give them tax incentives and other incentives to come here and build. We can use some of the programs we were talking about tonight as far as social housing, as well as increasing the density levels in some of our neighborhoods. Those we have to use everything in our toolbox. We have to use everything available to us in order to reach the numbers that we need to make sure that we're accommodating everyone who needs housing in Ward 3.
Thank you. Should DC acquire property in Ward 3 to build housing, and where should the funds come from? Henry Cohen.
I'll take the microphone out of its little stand here.
I don't know, actually.
Guess I can. So there's a question that it has a pretty straightforward answer. Yes, we should be acquiring new land, and where should the money come from? Big business. At the Chamber of Commerce Forum last Friday, every single candidate here, beau notwithstanding, refused to tell them straight up that they will raise their taxes. I did. I looked down the camera, I looked right at the Chamber of Commerce and told them that I will raise their taxes. And I'm gonna do that to ensure that every single person can afford to live in Ward 3, because it's time for big business to pay their fair share. It's time to make sure that the people who live here can live here with dignity, can live here with respect, can live here in order to support our community. And so it's a simple answer. Yes, we should be building it. Yes, we should be buying land, and it should come from big business. When it comes to things like eminent domain for the Wardman Hotel, I support that. I support anything that will put land in the hands of the government in order to build housing on. And that money is going to come from big business. I cannot stress it enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Tricia Duncan.
Thank you. I'm setting my timer. Thank you. So I'm going to be totally honest here. If the city is going to be buying land in Ward 3, I would really like it to be for schools, because everything is seriously overcrowded. One thing I think we could do is use the land the city owns better to build affordable housing. So like the Chevy Chase small area plan, let's build housing over all of our libraries, rec centers. Let's make it easier for places of faith to build affordable housing on their land that they own. Let's let an out parcel McDonald's build affordable housing above their things. But I'm going to be totally honest here. If the city's going to be buying land in Ward 3, I am the candidate for schools, and we are in desperate need of schools. Thank you.
All right. Matthew Fuhrman.
So the city should definitely buy land in order to be able to build affordable housing. The biggest example of the city buying land that would enable us to build affordable housing is RFK. I know it's not in Ward 3, but there are places that are owned by NPS in Ward 3, the Triangle Park at Tenley Circle, other sites by Davenport off of Reno Road, that the city could buy the land, use a fund, get the land, and then enter into a partnership with a developer and get the money back for the land and have affordable housing go up. So there are ways for us to be creative. We also have to be creative in all kinds of other ways. We at the Lisner Home used a part of our campus and we're going to build affordable housing. Faith-based organizations can look at, is there land that they may have available that they could use to build affordable housing? We should be encouraging all of those things, but one tool in the toolbox is buying land and partnering with developers to get affordable housing there.
Thank you, Matthew. Monty Monash.
So I want to say that when we are thinking about purchasing land as a city and developing affordable housing or any type of long-term managed property, it's not the best suit for the District of Columbia. We don't have a great track record of it. So I know that we need to be in partnership with an outside developer or organization to make sure that it's managed and maintained well. I do believe that we do need affordable housing throughout the district, especially in this ward, land is at premium. So finding those site locations, making sure that it is large enough to accommodate the affordable housing units that we're looking to have. But if it's a tract that's larger than what a housing development would be, we have to consider other uses because we do have so many needs right now in the district for both senior wellness, senior centers, affordable housing, and schools. So I think it's a mixed conversation for me is that we have to look at lots of different reasons for having affordable housing being developed by the district. Thank you.
Thank you. Eric Goulet.
Thank you. Back in 2014, I was excited to work with Wynn and the CNHED to work on this specific issue. And that was, we had budget surpluses every year back then. And you know, there was a lot of concern about that because the CFO was conservative in its revenue estimates. And at the end of the year, there'd be a budget surplus. Well, what we did working with Wynn, working with the affordable housing community was to dedicate 50% of our surpluses at the end of the year to the Housing Production Trust Fund and the other 50% to pay-as-you-go capital. And why that's really important now is when there's a budget surplus, hundreds of millions of dollars each year go into the Housing Production Trust Fund. And I'd like to commend the mayor for adding more than that this year. We had about $200 million and she added another $300 to the fund. So that's really exciting. That allows us to do a lot, but it's not infinite, so we need to use it wisely. I support, rather than perhaps buying land, trying to leverage additional financing on space where there's development going on right now and doing that through additional density and focusing on really trying to get affordable housing in the ward through the Housing Production Trust Fund.
Thank you. Ben Bergman.
So I'm gonna echo what everybody else said. I mean, I think you see this work in New York where they have a fund that acquires properties. And one of the things that you can do is we can leverage the fact that there are certain places that could pay for themselves more than others. And we can be entrepreneurial about that. But we will have the ability to maximize affordable housing beyond the inclusionary zoning, which is obviously too low at the moment. But we could go beyond that because we control the site, which is one reason why we need a master plan to redevelop all public buildings. Schools can have housing on top of them. That's true if you go to New York. Libraries can have housing on top of them. Police stations can have housing on top of them. If the list goes on, we need to have a systematic approach to it. That's the thing that I think is missing. We cannot have a discussion about every single property. Should we have housing on this library? Should we have housing on this library? It doesn't match the scale of the problem that's facing us. So let's have a systematic plan and implement it over a course of time. Thanks.
Thank you. Bo Finley.
So yes, we should be acquiring property. We should be acquiring land. You know, I mentioned this earlier. I think the district should be building a portfolio of housing and using the profits from that after, you know, paying for capital upkeep to invest in affordable housing. We should be using the Housing Production Trust Fund to buy units in buildings, which is what Montgomery County does, and make them available to those at or below 30% MFI. Now, the Housing Production Trust Fund right now doesn't help people below 60% MFI. We need to use it to do so. We need to get deeply affordable housing. The way we do that is by acquiring property, building the housing ourselves with profits from those properties, and maintaining our housing stock in a dignified way. Thank you.
And Phil Thomas.
Thank you, Bo. You're welcome.
So first, the city needs to continue to invest in the Housing Production Trust Fund. It gives the district and the government the real flexibility it needs for to partner with developers to create real deep affordable housing. As the government doesn't have a good track record on delivering affordable units, that they need to partner with somebody like a developer to do that. Also, before we acquire land, we need to invest in the public land that we already have and build housing on top of that, like the Chevy Chase Smart Area Plan, as well as our library and our community center definitely needs housing on top of it and definitely needs to be remodeled. And then we should use every tool in the toolbox to invest in privately owned land and then develop that as well in affordable housing. As well as a senior, as somebody who wants a senior wellness center in Ward 3 on public land that's ADA accessible and metro accessible, we should definitely put a senior wellness center in Ward 3 and put affordable housing as well as workforce housing on top of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, candidates. We'll move on now to our fourth question. And the question is this. In the mid 20th century, residents got zoning laws changed to limit small apartment buildings on streets off Connecticut Avenue because, quote, the wrong kind of people were moving in. Is zoning a tool we could use to build affordable and inclusive housing? As council member, how would you use zoning to increase housing in Ward 3? We'll call first on Erica Goulet.
Well, zoning was part of the problem before, so it needs to be part of the solution now. I mean, we need to work very closely with the Zoning Commission. And what I want to do, if elected, is to get together a group of experts on these issues, experts on zoning, experts on planning within the ward, to talk about how we can create a community that everyone feels a part of here in Ward 3. And I really think what we can do, if we get the right people in the room, is figure out a way that we can truly get the mix that we're looking for in the ward, making sure we can bring our workforce back to Ward 3, who serves our community, our teachers, our firefighter EMTs, our police officers, that they can live here in the ward, making sure that we're doing our share to help the most vulnerable in the city. No, particularly residents who are homeless or maybe experiencing mental health issues. We wanna make sure that they are welcome here in Ward 3 as well. And that we, throughout the city, the Ward 3 will then be a shining beacon for what we can do as a community by accepting people in and by expecting that the services the government provides truly serve the needs of those residents here in Ward 3.
Thank you. Next, Tricia Duncan.
Thank you. I'm going to set my timer. Sorry. Thank you very much. Zoning. Yes, one of the reasons why I got
council member, how would you use zoning to increase housing in Ward 3?
Thank you. One of the reasons why I decided to run for office was to be here when the comprehensive plan was redrawn. I am a big believer in the need to go vertical. The shade changing in someone's backyard does not produce suffering. People living in tent encampments produces suffering. And if we are going to really tackle the housing crisis and move our city into the next decade, we are going to need to go vertical. I believe that this can happen along the corridors, especially near the metro stations, including Cleveland Park, so that we can get the maximum number of units, including affordable units, available to the public. And I can make a commitment for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Ben Bergman.
So the answer is yes. Zoning has to be part of the solution. It's not the solution. When we talk about deeply affordable units, that's where I think zoning changes alone are not going to be able to deliver some of those. But you know, making it possible to build a row home in every neighborhood in the district, which is not currently legal in parts of Ward 3 because of minimum lot size requirements, that single thing, we're not even talking about single family zoning. We're not even talking about multifamily apartments. We're just talking about being able to build smaller homes. That's going to deliver a lot of units. Looking at neighborhood by neighborhood where we can build apartment buildings that were there before some of these zoning changes. You go to Cleveland Park, there are apartment buildings there. They can't build one right next door anymore. I live in an apartment building across from a single family neighborhood. And guess what? It's a dynamic place. There are three restaurants. There's a shopping center because of density. It's not a threat. It's something that enriches a community. And that's the way we need to talk about it. with folks because we have to build more homes. Thanks.
Thank you. Monty Monash.
Thank you. Zoning, we do need to work with the zoning board to change the zoning regulations. It's going to help the community to have some creativity in what we do. But what's really important here is that the inclusive nature of our community is really at stake. We have a storied past, it continues to this day. And I think that we have to make sure that we speak to how do we make it affordable, not just with the housing, but everything else around it. So it means that we need to have a plan. We need to start in a planning phase. We need to make sure that we are including different types of stakeholders, not just residents, but also developers, also congregations and other folks within the ward, to business owners, to make sure that we are creating an inclusive and affordable community. So having affordable housing, but not having grocery stores where folks can shop is a big issue. So you don't really feel included or wanted here if you can't afford to really truly live, learn, work, and play here. Thank you.
Matthew Fruman.
So can we use zoning as a way of promoting affordable housing? I mean, sitting in this place and looking out at this audience, we have. I mean, we work together in the Wynn Coalition on the comprehensive plan to encourage more density on our corridors for precisely the reason to allow for more affordable housing. And actually, it's the Wynn Coalition and things like it that are more important than the council member, because the Wynn Coalition testifies in front of the Zoning Commission on issues like this, and it really matters when a lot of residents care. The next place it came up for me is we got the future land use map changed for the Lisner home, and then we got a zoning change that allowed us to build 93 deeply affordable senior housing units. And we did it working with our neighbors and winning them over so that they testified in support of us at the Zoning Commission and the Historic Preservation Review Board. We can do it if we work together, and zoning is one of the tools.
Thank you. How would you use zoning to increase housing in Ward 3? Phil Thomas.
Yes, as the president of the Federation of Community Associations, I have listened to community groups all around the city about how to build more affordable housing, not just in Ward 3, but across the city. As we know that zoning plays a big part in that, and the zoning law has changed, but it also takes a bridge builder. It also takes somebody who knows the stakeholders in the community. It also takes somebody who can deliver. As somebody who's a bridge builder in this community, as somebody who has delivered for this community to bring the short-term family housing site and to bring more housing, I can do that. I know the community very well. I know how to negotiate. I know how to deliver for the community. Thank you.
Thank you. Henry Cohen.
So this is a great question, and specifically the first part of this question, when you were introducing it, is something that really stood out to me about how residents opposed changing the zoning laws, or residents put more stringent zoning laws because it would bring the wrong kind of people to Ward 3. And that is something that you could have lifted right from the Glover Park listserv. I live in Glover Park and had to watch new developments be shot down because it would bring the wrong kind of people here, because it would destroy the neighborhood character. Blatant lies. Glover Park itself is home to many smaller apartment buildings, home to many larger apartment buildings. It has maintained its neighborhood character throughout it all. Through things like ending single family zoning, ending mansion zoning, we can allow more density to be built, which will in turn drive down prices of housing. And by making sure that developers can build these apartments, things like that, we can force them to add more affordable housing, force them to add housing that is accessible to everybody, social housing. Truly, this is a remnant of the segregation era, a remnant of redlining, and it's something that must end. It must end today. Thank you.
Bo Finley.
So this should be easy for me. I agree with Henry. So Ward 3 has a dark history of exclusion. You go two blocks west of here up Porter Street, you'll see apartment buildings that are currently illegal to build because they bring the wrong kind of people here. Ward 3 has a history of redlining, restrictive covenants, the clearing of the Reno neighborhood. And so we need to change our zoning to bring back housing. And that's something that I worked very hard on a few years ago during the comprehensive plan amendment process. I drafted an amendment for, it's called Amendment 2123, if anybody feels like reading it. But I drafted an amendment to increase the maximum zoning in Cleveland Park because we're sitting in a transit corridor. We've got a metro station, we've got 5 or 6 bus lines. It's a perfect place to build more housing. But instead we've got a 1- and 2-story business strip with no housing above it or very little housing. So I worked on this amendment. I got community support for it. I got it through my ANC. I got it to the Office of Planning, and the Office of Planning brought it to council, and council supported it. And so now we have the potential to build more housing in Cleveland Park up to 6 or 7 stories. So that's residential housing that will bring affordable housing too. Thank you.
Thank you. And Deidre Brown.
Thank you. So we all know that zoning has been used in the past to keep certain people out. So yes, we should be using zoning now in a very strategic way to let more people in. If we're gonna say that we want Ward 3 to be inclusive and equitable, then we need to actually take action. I would like to see the zoning change so we can have more mixed use properties along our corridors, especially near where people work, as well as where there's more transportation. This housing should include 3+ bedrooms for our families, and it should include multi-generational housing so some of our seniors can live and work there as well. The bottom should have restaurants and retail and grocery stores and libraries and educational centers. People should be able to live and work here in Ward 3 if this is where they want to call home. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to move now to our fifth and final topic for this evening. Let me give a bit of introduction. A recent change in our COVID world is an influx of money to help people move into housing, including here in Ward 3. We in the faith-based and housing advocacy communities are grateful for this. The coexistence of people of different racial, social, and economic backgrounds can be difficult to navigate in normal times. COVID and recent incidents in Upper Northwest have made this adjustment more difficult, and it is showing in our public discourse. So the question I pose to the candidates is this: how would you address the vitriolic talk around vouchers, combat divisiveness, improve discourse, and create a more welcoming community for all? I'll call first on Phil Thomas.
So yes, there's been a lot of talk about vouchers around Ward 3, especially on the Connecticut Avenue corridor. I definitely think as Ward 3 council member, I'll be sympathetic to hearing people, and people have valid concerns, but you also gotta let them know that the voucher program is working, as there definitely needs to be more coordination and communications between agencies, as well as through MPD, as well as the landlord and the tenant. As well as the management needs to have more training as well. And also we need more coordination between behavioral health and mental health as well. But we definitely, I definitely want to continue the program. I definitely think that it's moving in the right direction. It needs to be tweaked. But I like how we are bringing different residents in the community from different backgrounds, as well as different income levels as well. And I definitely think this is needed in Ward 3. Thank you.
Thank you. Ben Bergman.
Yeah, so this is a difficult subject. It's a difficult subject to be a candidate right now talking to people about this issue because I've been deeply troubled by the comments that I've heard from people who are good progressive Democrats at the doors. I've been troubled by comments I've heard from people on the stage. And I've been deeply troubled by comments from the incumbent council member. I think the key for a leader is to recognize when it's time to push back on nonsense. There are reasons to be concerned about the implementation of the program that is also being conflated with many programs, but oversight is important. But at the end of the day, we cannot indulge in paranoia and anxieties that are that conflate different issues, and we need to have a council member that summons people to do what's right and not to demonize your neighbor, but to think about how we can build a community that involves all of us, because that's supposedly what the signs all say in the yards, and they should be what we live in our hearts. Thank you.
Thank you. Matt Fruman.
So I like the way you asked the question about how to stop the vitriol, because I mean, that is really my wheelhouse. I have engaged on issue after issue in this area and brought the temperature down by showing respect for people who are on both sides of the issue, listening to them and trying to look for solutions. Now, this program, recently the deputy mayor who oversees this program had talked at an ANC meeting about all of the problems in implementation. Housing first implies something that comes next. We need to have wraparound services for these people. We need to be helping them in every way, just as we need to be helping the people in rapid rehousing. But we shouldn't blind ourselves and think that there are no issues. There are issues. And the people who are raising issues about this program want it to work also. So the vitriol goes in multiple directions here, and we need to bring the temperature down. And if it's worth doing, it's worth doing right. And that's the way we need to approach the voucher program.
Thank you. Deidre Brown.
So I'm a third generation native Washingtonian. So I've seen the city change over the years. And what I will say to you, Ward 3 neighbors, is we need to be respectful and kind to our neighbors. We need to understand that everyone who's on a housing voucher does not come from a certain demographic, and there's various reasons why people are on vouchers, mostly because they need a place to live. And so let's come together as a community, figure out who needs assistance, additional assistance, and who does not. But let's not name call and attack our neighbors, because that's not how we move forward in Ward 3. Thank you.
Beau Findlay.
So when we see somebody speaking ill of somebody just because they're poor, we have to say something. We have to tell them, no, that's not right. We cannot demonize somebody. We cannot take advantage of somebody's misfortune. We need to tell them, no, that's not right. And we need to say it and explain why and show them, there but for the grace of God go I. We don't need to do this just for the person who's being insulted, just for the person who's being misunderstood. We need to do it for ourselves, for our society. When we see something like that, we need to call it out and say, hey, look, we can do better. Here's what we're trying to do. We're trying to keep people housed. We're trying to make sure they have the dignity of having a roof over their heads. So with the vitriol, yeah, just tell people to stop it. When you see it, tell them what they're doing. Explain to them why they're wrong. We need transitional housing for those who aren't apartment ready. We need permanent supportive housing for those who need it. Frankly, we need a better support system, and that's coming out in the sort of difficulties that rent-stabilized buildings are having. I've been impressed by the nuance and sensitivity of the tenant associations along Connecticut Avenue that are working through this difficult discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Trisha Duncan.
Yes, thank you. I'm actually very, very passionate about this, because as I said, in my neighborhood in Palisades, we have two buildings with these voucher tenants. So I have heard the vitriol from the surrounding community again and again and again. And what I have done is offer solutions. So I have been on the Zooms with the Department of Health, and there are so many things that a community could do to support these tenants. And people will welcome this housing if they're able to have a relationship with the tenants and bring them into the community. But the way that things are set up now, the city cannot tell you that these tenants are in fact vouchers. They cannot tell you who they are, where they live, because of privacy. And I get that. But as council member, I'm going to create mechanisms that allow a community with heart to support these residents, to make them part of the community. And I think that that's what it's going to take. We're going to need new partnerships and different ideas. I think my time is up and my timer hasn't gone off. Thank you.
Thank you. How would you address vitriolic talk and create a more welcoming community for all? Monty Monash.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank Ben and Deidre for their comments. I think it's important to know that folks feel welcome. Ward 3 we learned in our last forum on Friday last week that 5% of African-Americans live in this ward. So when someone's different, it really stands out to folks in this neighborhood, in this community. And it can be a very unwelcoming place, despite what we all want to believe. And so we have to be about our heart. We have to be about the values that we're saying that we're standing for. And there's no way that we can do that as a government. All we can do is make sure that we have open doors. And as a council person, making sure that I'm able to listen and to also hear both sides of the story, but like recognizing the fact that we have to all come together and support folks that are in a crisis, in a situation where it's not their control. Folks don't elect to be housing insecure or homeless or on a voucher program. It's something that the city must support and help. Thank you.
Thank you. Eric Goulet.
Well, when I walked around getting petition signatures, I asked residents what their concerns were. And this program was mentioned, by a number of residents here in the ward. And it wasn't, though, I didn't hear vitriol from anyone or anybody wanting to be unwelcoming. But what I heard was concerns about how the program was being managed and really deep concerns about it, because there are issues. I met with five tenant associations on this issue, and the concerns involved domestic violence, drug dealing, people with mental health issues who aren't getting services that they need. And that's a failure of the city. The city, we had the wrong deputy mayor, frankly, at that meeting. It wasn't the deputy mayor that should have been there. It was the deputy mayor for public safety that was there. We should have had the deputy mayor for health and human services at the meeting. And the city needs to do a better job on this program, because people in the program aren't being served well. And I'd also like to stick up for Mary Che on this issue. I think something she said may be misconstrued, because I've spoken with her on this issue before. And what she's looking for is just making sure that we're not putting too many people with challenges all in one building, because we've tried to de-densify with DC General, with other structures, not trying to overload people with challenges together. We want to spread that out to make sure those challenges can be met in a humane and smart way.
Thank you. And Henry Cohen will have the last word.
I'm very glad that I got to have the last word on this, because I feel like it's something that's very important and very close to me. These pins here that some of you are wearing, some of my fellow candidates are wearing, and the pin that I will continue to wear, say Ward 3 for all in them. That means Ward 3 that works for everybody. That means Ward 3 that works for people who can't afford fancy housing. Ward 3, that means Ward 3 that works for the working class. What that does not mean that we are, giving voice to people who are going to be demeaning, people who are going to be racist to voucher holders, anything like that. It does not mean that we're going to act like there's any kind of merit to claims that people on voucher holders are drug dealers, or people on voucher holders are dangerous, because there is absolutely no correlation. There's no reason to claim something like that. It is disgusting behavior and something that needs to be stopped. I wish that was something that we were just hearing from the Republicans in the race, but fortunately it's not. Somebody's got to say it. This needs to end now. I have no sympathy for anybody who's going to come in here and mistreat voucher holders. Voucher holders are our neighbors. Voucher holders help build this community. And voucher holders are important members of this community. And they're going to continue to stay important members of this community. That is why we must end this stigmatization. We must end this mistreatment. We must end this vitriol. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to all our candidates this evening for their presence, for the views that they've shared. I also want to say to them that this candidates forum is just one in a series of many ways that we from the Washington Interfaith and Friendship Place communities are engaging public officials on this issue. So we look forward to continuing this conversation with all of you as your candidacies continue, and for whoever is elected to continuing to work with you as well. So let's express our appreciation to our candidates. And I want to now invite forward Rabbi Hannah Goldstein, who will be closing us out with a call to action.
Thank you, Anne. I'm Rabbi Hannah Goldstein. I'm a rabbi at Temple Sinai, which is technically in Ward 4, but we are Ward 3 adjacent, and many of our congregants live in Ward 3. I want to begin by thanking Addis Israel for hosting us this evening, and also Wynn and Friendship Place, the leaders who put this evening's program together. And of course, I want to thank all of the Ward 3 council candidates that participated. We are grateful for your time and your commitment to Ward 3 and to DC.
As we've said in the past, WIN doesn't endorse candidates, but we want you to endorse us. So know that we are here, the 200 plus of us that joined in person and online, the Ward 3 faith institutions or Ward 3 adjacent, the students of Ward 3, the organizations that provide services for Ward 3 residents. Know that we are here, know that we are paying attention, know that we vote, and know that we are not going anywhere. Tonight, we got a glimpse of big ideas in tiny time slots. We talked about housing and the environment, about supporting our neighbors, creating a Ward 3 for all. And we look forward to partnering with you and, when necessary, pushing you to build the Ward 3 community that will serve and nurture all of us, that sees the dignity in every resident of this ward, a ward that does its part in providing green, safe, affordable housing. And all of us gathered tonight, we took time in a busy week to engage in this process, to be part of building a better Ward 3, building a ward in which we listen to our neighbors, we support each other, we stay in relationship with each other, and that's hard work. It is slow work. It doesn't end with the budget. It doesn't end with the election season. So I invite all of you who are here, who are watching on Zoom, to stay engaged, to keep talking to your neighbors, to keep talking to your fellow congregants, your classmates, to be engaged citizens necessary to build a more just city. In the Jewish faith, we are in the period of counting the Omer, which we ritually count each of the days, 49 days from Passover to Shavuot, the 49 days between the holidays celebrating liberation from Egypt to the holidays celebrating revelation at Sinai, one day at a time for 49 days. It is a time on the Jewish calendar that brings us to a heightened awareness of the passage of time. As we count every day, we are reminded to make every day count. In a world where the problems are big and we can feel small, in our neighborhoods, in our congregations, we have tremendous power. We count, and we can use that power to make sure that in Ward 3, all of our residents have a chance and all of our residents count. Thank you for joining us tonight.